Hello. Today, I'll try to talk about the final days of the Ottoman Empire and the establishment of Turkish Republic. Again, I will try to cover the main important events, so I will not go into details. And first of all, I will try to talk a little bit about the last days of the Ottoman Empire, the National Independence War years, and then I will try to talk about the establishment of Turkish Republic. We know that actually Turkish Republic was built on the heritage, on the legacy of Ottoman Empire, despite the radical changes. Right now I'm going to try to make a summary about this historical important events. First of all, I prepared some notes for myself, but I want to talk of myself, you know. I don't want to read this in front of the video. As we all know, in 1919 is the date when the National Independence War began. For 4 years until the establishment of Turkish Republic in 1923, National Independence War, İstiklal Savaşı in Turkish, was fought against the European forces. During those years, we know that there were not only the in the army, the majority were not only the Muslims, but there were Muslims, non-Muslims, Kurdish people, or Alevi people. So taking the heritage of the Ottoman Empire, there were many different groups fighting for national independence. In fact, this is an important issue, because we know that after the independence war, Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, with the establishment of the republic, began to homogenize the country. So, through establishing a national homogeneous Turkish identity, some particular groups of the previous decades were steadily excluded from the public sphere and from many other spheres, actually. But the thing is that the National Independence War was fought with a group of many people. So there were Muslims, non-Muslims, but at the end of the war, some of the people were somehow excluded were not treated as equal citizens in the modern Turkish Republic. So from 1919 until 1923, the years were characterized by the National Independence War years, we can say. In those years, an important event is the abolition of the Sultanate. So abolition of the Sultanate was an important event in those years. On the other hand, another important thing is the signing of the Sèvres Treaty. It was signed in 1920. The Allied powers were on the other side of the table. But we know that after some time, the Sèvres Treaty was removed from service, or was removed from legal procedures. An important event in those years is the compulsory population. So population exchange. We know that there was a population exchange between Turkey and the Greek party, and this population exchange in nüfus mübadelesi, actually it was carried out in a specific fashion. In this compulsory population exchange, we know that it was not based on ethnicity, but the religious identity was important in terms of exchanging the populations. So some of the non-Muslims were sent to the other party, and the Muslims were sent to Turkish territories. So this was another event. As I say, I'm not going into details, so maybe I can, I'm not giving the proper, you know, the enough information, but the events in a chronological order, the national independence war is in importance, is very important. Abolition of the Sultanate in this years is also important. Sèvres Treaty, but actually later it was removed. It was not fully implemented. The thing that we should know about population exchange is that it was not based on ethnic considerations, but the religious factor was an important thing about this changing the populations. So in 1923, another important event was witnessed. It is the signing of the Lausanne Peace Treaty. Actually, it was signed in 1923 in Switzerland, in Lausanne Conference. We know that it is the founding treaty of Turkish Republic, but it came into force 1 year after the Republic's foundation. So it came into force in 1924. In 1923, Atatürk and his associates established Turkish Republic. So this, but after this date, of course, very, very important steps were taken in order to build an homogeneous nation state. As we know that the heritage of the Ottoman Empire was a little bit challenging for the nation state formation because it was a multi-ethnic and multi-religious entity. So Mustafa Kemal Atatürk and his friends got engaged in a strict state modernization and nation building process in state formation years, and there were plenty of steps taken in order to modernize the society and in order to make society homogeneous. And in order to lose the ties with the Ottoman past. We can call these in general terms as the Kemalist reforms. And they were implemented in a number of areas. One of the areas is law, the other is education, and also there were important nationalization steps. You all know that the nationalization steps in the economic field was actually started in the Comité of Union and Progress, İttihat ve Terakki years. We know that there was a beginning of national economy construction, but also in the early years of the Republic, there was the statism, or in other words, etatism. So state got engaged in the economic processes as well. So I want to summarize just the main bodies of these reforms. In terms of law, we know that the Ottoman reforms based on religious considerations were removed. Instead of these reforms, secular Western type of legal regulations were made. On the other hand, in terms of education, we know that the religious schools, the madrasas, I think it's in English also madrasa, were abolished. Instead, modern secular schools were established. In terms of military and politics relationship, we can say that in the early Republican years, there emerged really important developments, because we know that the founding elites of the modern Turkey are from the military sphere. So Atatürk and his friends used to be military officers actually, but Atatürk also knew that the politicization of the army is not very good for a well-functioning political system. So in the early years of the Republic, Atatürk made some legal regulations, and he said that the army should keep away from active politics. So if you want to be a military officer, you shouldn't be active in the political affairs, or if you want to make politics, you should leave your role or leave your position in the army. So there was a strict distinction between the military and the political sphere in the early Republican years. Actually, this all the later this got weakened, and a number of military coups took place. And also, there are some other reforms were employed in the realm of religious affairs. For example, Directorate of Religious Affairs was built in 1930s, and this Directorate of Religious Affairs from the date that it was founded, actually it was subjected to many criticisms, because we know that normally the state elites somehow try to shape and control the religious activities and religious discourses, Islamic discourses in Turkey, through establishing such a directorate. So Diyanet, or Directorate of Religious Affairs, actually is not an institution that serves liberal secular understanding, but it serves the state's actually interest. So it promotes a specific sect, the Sunni sect of Islam, and the Alevi people, for example, were excluded from, you know, they were discriminated and they faced oppression from the state in terms of this Directorate of Religious Affairs. I think this is also is not compatible with the secularism principles, because through building such a directorate, promoting only one sect of Islam, the other segments of the society somehow face state discrimination. And this is also is against the spirit of secularism, because in a secular society, the state should have equal distance to all of the religious orientations. Also, another important thing that I should talk about in this presentation is the independence tribunals. I think these are also known in Turkish as istiklal mahkemeleri. So we know that in the early years of the Republic, there were really hard days. The state elites, the Kemalist reforms, somehow got engaged in erasing, in removing Islam and Islam-related signs, Islam-related symbols from the public sphere. But also, they didn't just do that on, you know, in terms of legal procedures, but they also implemented these policies in a very tyrannic way. So these independence tribunals, you know, some people were hung because of their clothes preferences. So in terms of the secularization policies, actually, the state got engaged in a very strict and inhumane from time to time practices. I think we also should be able to discuss the early Republic years, because there were some pathological policies in those years, and I think they even have today shadows. Sometimes, from time to time, we can all even feel their shadows even in today's Turkey. So, based on my summaries, we talked about the independence war years. You talk about population exchange, Lausanne Peace Treaty, abolition of the Sultanate, then the Caliphate, actually, and then the establishment of the Republic in 1923 by Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, then the steps taken in order to make the society a homogeneous entity, to build a modern secular Turkish national identity. So in the fields of law, education, military, politics, and religion, really important reforms were implemented. They actually all had one main reason: to create a modern Western style state apparatus, eliminating Islam from all of the segments of society and politics, and to create a pure modern secular system. But this secularism actually was a little bit similar to, not a little bit, I think much similar to the French type of secularism, not the Anglo-Saxon type, because it was too Oppressive in Ahmet Kruse words, Ahmet Kruse, a distinguished scholar working on state-religion relationship. If I am to borrow a concept from Kuru, I can say that this kind of secularism can be called as assertive secularism. In terms of the political affairs in the early Republican years, I want to talk about the establishment of some new parties. We know that the Republican People's Party were actually built on the groups coming from the independence years. So Anadolu ve Rumeli Mudafaa Hukuk Cemiyetleri. So they got combined and under one root, and they under the title of a Republican People's Party. But there were some attempts in order to introduce some new parties. Some attempts were undertaken. For example, in 1924, there was a political party that was founded in 1924, and it is called as Terakkiperver Cumhuriyet Fırkası. So this means Terakkiperver. The party that likes development. Actually, Terakki means development, I think, progress. But this party was also closed down after some time. And again, in 1930, there was another attempt to create an opposition party against Atatürk's political party. It was Serbest Cumhuriyet Fırkası, Free Republican Party. But again, Atatürk then closed this party as well, and he silenced all of the opposition in order to consolidate his power. In fact, Turkish, right now I want to talk a little bit about the Turkish nation building process. Actually, I want to make some important points that should be emphasized, I think, in order while analyzing these years. The first thing is about the role of the media. We know that the media, generally, in every country, it has the function of informing the masses. But most of the time, in many countries, if we examine historical experiences as well, sometimes the media was used by the elites in order to promote their own ideology, in order to make their dominance seem more visible, or in order to control or manipulate the masses. And in the early years of the Republic, the media was used as a tool, actually, as an instrument to shape the society in line with the Kemalist principles. So it was used like a Kemalist propaganda tool from time to time. This was something of course related to the nation building or state formation processes. So I think it's not a surprise to see this kind of practices, because it was a nation building process, and so it wasn't the elites somehow needed to promote their own ideology, and also they need to shape or manipulate the masses through use of media. Also, another important thing is the Directorate of Religious Affairs. I think I'm going to make another presentation just devoted to this issue, to the issue of Diyanet. I also want sent an abstract to a conference. I hope if my abstract is accepted, I can make a presentation about secularism and the Diyanet issue in Turkey. To make a long story short, I can say that Turkish nation building process was not, of course, an easy process. We should face the problematic practices that were experienced, that were witnessed in those years. But of course, while building a nation state, such activities somehow occur in many different contexts, because you have to build a secular identity, so it's very important. And the last thing that I want to talk about in this presentation, and I don't want to make it too long, it is the nation, it is the Turkish, it is related with the Turkish national identity. So what is Turkish national identity? According to Baskun Oran, Turkish Nation Identity has an acronym. I mean, an abbreviation. Baskın Orhan, Baskın Orhan also is famous with his studies about minority issues in Turkey. If you're interested in minority issues or yes, minority issues, you can have a look at Baskın Orhan's studies and articles. So the last thing that I want to address today is the Turkish national identity issue. So while building Turkish nation state, Baskın Orhan makes a conceptualization. He said that we can use an abbreviation for the, you know, desired citizens of Turkey. And this is what I tried to cover in my PhD thesis, the desired, the undesired citizens I covered. But actually, Baskın Orhan made an abbreviation and said that Laha Sümüt. What does this mean? What does this mean? Laik, Hanefi, Sünni, Müslüman, Türk. So in English it means secular, Hanefi, Sünni, Muslim and Turk. So if you're a Kurdish, if you're an Alevi, if you're a non-Muslim, or if you are not secular, but if you're a pious Muslim, you were, you know, excluded, or you were, you faced some state, hard state policies. Also, there is a book called Makbul Yurttaşlık or Desired Citizenship, something like this. Right now, I cannot remember. Maybe I have it in my, I'm looking at my library, in my library, written by Füsun Üstel. Füsun Üstel also talks about this undesired citizens. Also, I want to offer you another book, and I can see it right now. I'm going to take it from my library. It is Müstakbel Türk'ten Sözde Vatandaşa, from the future Turk to the so-called citizen, the Republic and the Kurdish citizens. This is a book written by Mesut Uyan. Mesut Uyan is also a very distinguished researcher working on Kurdish issue in Turkey. So if you are interested in the homogenization processes and the other segments of society like Kurdish, the Alevis, you can read the book of Mesut Yeğen. If you are interested in the direct religious of directorate, directorate of religious affairs, you can read the works of İştar Gözaydın. Her works are very important addressing the Diyanet issue. Today, these are the points that I covered today. In my next presentation, I want to talk about the Democrat Party era, the introduction of the multi-party politics, in 1946, under the leadership of Adnan Menderes, Democrat Party was founded, and the days following this, what happened then, the military coup and the other developments, I will try to cover these. And I want to thank you very much for listening to me today. And I'm gonna put the important key concepts, important events, and important books like that of Mesut Uyan under the video. If you are interested, you can also look at these books. Thank you very much. Bye bye.